Greetings from Dr. Health Gurus, Revealed Medicine Forum Ministries. Greetings in the most holy name of Jesus. Are you a weed? Are you a seed? Are you a seed of a weed? Or are you a seed of God's word? Are we weed or seed of God? Quickly, let us turn to the word of God in Luke chapter 18, verse 8. When the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? When the Son of Man, Jesus, comes, will he find faith on earth? Will he find? Let us talk about the present. Look around. Faith is thriving or faithlessness is thriving? Yeah, faithlessness is thriving all around, prevailing all around. Quickly. I guess you are saying, yes, brother, faithlessness is all around the world around us. All around there is faithlessness in the world and unbelievers. We have to pray for them. I am sorry. I am talking about faithlessness in the church. I am talking unbelief and faithlessness and unholiness in the church, in the believers, among the followers of God, among so-called Christians. Yeah. Word of God, if you go to the Word of God in Matthew chapter 13, verse 24 to 30, the Word of God tells about wheat and weeds. Weeds and wheat growing. I know many of you hearing this are wheat, seed of weeds, crying out to God to do something to stop these weeds. Of course, God is silent, I guess. He is gathering it all for the judgment day. Coming back to our point, I'm talking about the faithlessness we see in the church. The church, the Christians, the believers, the worship leaders who claim to be children of God, who claim to be followers of God, attributes exhibit same attributes, same characters, and common characters that the unbelievers share. In other words, whatever a non-believer, unbeliever is doing, we are also doing. And we say, we are the faithful. We are Christians following God. We are children of God. We have the spirit of adoption, crying out to God as Abba, Father, and whatnot. But your action and the action in the world among unbelievers, there is no much difference, son. There is no much difference, daughter. There is no much difference, uncle, auntie. There is no much different, pastor. There is no much different, you priest. Man of God, woman of God, there is no much difference. In fact, don't be surprised. Going to other religions, I'm not talking about religion here, but still, to say I have to use the word religions like Hinduism and Christianity. Sorry, in Hinduism or in Muslim culture, Muslim churches, Muslim mosque, you cannot play the fool. One cannot play the fool like many Christian people play in the church premises. Yes. You cannot, hold hands and go inside a temple. You cannot, cuddle each other in the temple premises. You cannot do all these romantic things which you do in a church worship hall, in a mosque. You cannot caress the hair of your fiancé or the would-be inside the premise of, a worship center or a Hindu religion or a Muslim thing. You cannot. We cannot. But to our surprise, I have seen in churches and worship centers, couples come. They are not even married. They occupy the adjacent chairs and the worship goes on. And here the couples are in a different world at times. They are at times filled with some emotions. I do not know what spirit it is. They suddenly, they cuddle each other. They hold hands each other. And the girl will be, putting her head on the shoulder of the boy. And one side, they are one hand saying hallelujah and worshipping. Another side, all emotional, drama unfolding. And sometimes, it is funny or it is ridiculous to see in a worship place where we are worshipping and glorifying God, emotions and feelings and romance are a bit glorified here and there, and the church pastor is silent. He can't say anything because perhaps he is afraid if you really speak against that person will leave and go. Yeah, leave the church. I think so. I do not know. You may call me old-fashioned. Oh, I can't understand your justification regarding these romantic gestures inside the church. I can't understand your theology and propagation and justification and your support regarding all the fashion show that is happening in your church hall, in the worship center. Yeah, I may be old-fashioned, but I can't understand the theology of defiling holy places with all these actions of the flesh, which you call it as culture. I can't understand the, people telling that this is all fun, but what you call as fun has a different meaning in the Bible. It is called sin. For you, a romance inside the church hall is a fun. You are going to get married and all other justification. But my dear sister, my dear brother, my dear church member, my dear daughter of the pastor, my dear wife of the pastor, my dear ministers, my dear sisters, beware. Beware. What is the difference between you and an unbeliever? The word of God says in Matthew 5:16, the word of God says, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good work and glorify the Father in heaven. And the unbeliever, I bring unbeliever to the church, a new Christian to a new Hindu to the church, or somebody to the church, and they attend the worship. And when they see all your cuddlings and carousing and all the romantic actions in the church, worship. Does it support Matthew 5:16? The actions you do in the church, the dressing sense you exhibit in the church, the fashion show you do in the church, all the buttering talk you do in the church, and all other flesh promoting kind of things you do in the church, does it uphold Matthew 5:16? Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works. What is the good work at times we see in the church? All these emotional things, all these fashion shows. And in what way it will glorify God? Does it serve, does your action inside the church premises serve as an instrument, an action to glorify what God's word demand on Matthew 5:16? It is not only in the church premises I am talking about, even in the other places. What is the difference between you and the world? Whatever it is practiced in the world, you are bringing it in another form inside the church premises, inside the church, inside your worship centers, and exhibiting it, just thus satisfying yourself, your psychological flesh needs, and justifying it using different theological backdrops. Oh, alas, I can't understand this. Lo, I can't understand this. That your light is shining before others. The question is, who is converting you? Who is influencing you? You and your behaviors and your characters and your lifestyle is it influencing the world? Or the lifestyle and the patterns and behavior patterns of the world is influencing you? You want to practice it, you little bit put some sugar coating and bring it into the church and in your home, in Christian homes, and simply say, justify yourself. God sees our heart, not the external things. So God knows our heart. No, I doubt. Because what is in your heart, the needs of the heart, will exhibit outside also. Many times. Church, I call to you. Friend, church-going friend, when you share the traits, when you do all that, you know, all the torn pants, your trousers are torn here and there, and you come with that torn trousers to worship, and the world also does that. And when they see you with all this, you know, heavily chemicalized hair and complete thick chemical makeups and all the high heels and, you know, very exposing cloth patterns, ornaments or whatever it is, when they see you, your light will so shine before others, they think you are one among them. You will be not be influencing them. They will influence you and they will come to fellowship with you. Why? Because you are also in their level. You are not able to give the gospel, proper gospel. You so-called are inviting to them to be like you and you like them, and total mess. When the Son of Man comes, will he see faith on earth, church? When the Son of Man comes, will he see faith on earth? That is what Jesus said. Look all around. Anyone who speaks about this, they become their enemies. There are different associations propagating homosexuality, lesbianism and what not. Theology supporting there are. I don't know what to say. I have only one thing to say. What does the Word of God say in this regard? The Word of God says in John chapter 14 verse 17 says, the Spirit of the truth, Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit, the world cannot receive. You church member, you pastor, you daughter and son of pastor, you relatives of big bishops, or you church member, you believer, you say you believe that you have received the Spirit of God, you are God is your Father, you say John 14:17 that the world cannot receive the Spirit of truth, but I have received, we know the Spirit of truth, and you claim that, but your actions are equal to the actions of the world. And how can you say that you can claim John 14:17, you can believe that? Spirit of truth, have you received? If you have received the Spirit of truth, the truth in you will guide you to follow Matthew 5:16, your light will so shine before others that they will see your good work, your walk of life, and come to Christ. Not come to church. Coming to church is easy. Now anybody can go to any church. Come to Christ. If you have received the Spirit of truth, if you falsely believe that you have received the Spirit of truth, the litmus test is your ways. The fruits of the Holy Spirit. Where are your fruits? And quickly, I want to add something. If anyone who is watching there thinks and believes in all what you are saying may be right, but I am all beyond this. This all is not applicable to me. You know, whatever I do, I wear torn trousers. I go with ring on my ears and pierce my body parts. Put tattoos all around. And sometimes go to pubs for some socially drink, but I still believe I am a child of God. I am not the child of devil. I follow the Word of God. I am sure about my ticket to heaven. Then excuse me, forgive me, sorry, this is not for you. I am preaching, I am sharing my thoughts to those who want to think. Don't believe me. Go to the Word of God and validate what I say. Take it for yourself. I am not your judge. Ultimately, it is between you and God, not me. I do my duty. I have nothing against you personally. But my dear preacher, my dear senior prayer group leader, when I saw your daughter in Instagram, like a bikini model, my heart stopped for a second. You are a leader of a prayer group. You are a senior member of a prayer group and your daughter is posing with bikini and it is in Instagram. And you have nothing to do about that. You are silent about that. Your silence is indirectly promoting your daughter to go to devil and his kingdom. Don't you care? And you call it as fashion. And you tell, it's okay, brother, they will change. When will they change? When will they change? By her bikini modeling, how much lust, spirit of lust, she has been pushing out, do you know? Don't call it as fashion, my dear brother. Oh, pastor, I know your daughter into drugs. She is secretly receiving counseling. She is into drugs. But you cannot correct her. Your words have no effect on her because she has seen no light in you. What you preach in the pulpit and what your real life is different. So your word to your daughter will mean nothing to her. And another servant of God. Yes, your daughter is doing PhD, but she is in love with a boy who is a terrible unbeliever and you are unable to do anything. Church, I called you. I do my duty. Where are your fruits, church? Where are your fruits? Where is your fruit? Fruits of the Holy Spirit. Where?